Hello, this is Sheila Bender, and you are listening to In Conversation, Discussions on Writing and the Writing Life. Today we have Abigail Thomas with us in conversation. She is the daughter of renowned science writer Lewis Thomas, Lives of the Cell, and the mother of four children and the grandmother of 12. Her academic education stopped when, pregnant with her oldest daughter, she was asked to leave Bryn Mawr during her first year. She lived most of her life on Manhattan's Upper West Side and was for a time a book editor and for another time a book agent. Then she started writing for publication. Her first three books, Getting Over Tom, An Actual Life, and Herb's Pajamas, were works of fiction. Her memoir, A Three-Dog Life, was named one of the best books of 2006 by the Los Angeles Times and the Washington Post. It won the 2006 Inspirational Memoir Award, given by Books for a Better Life. She is also author of Safekeeping, a memoir, and Thinking About Memoir. Her newest book is What Comes Next and How to Like It, also a memoir. She lives in Woodstock, New York, with her three dogs. Welcome, Abigail.
Thank you, Sheila. It's lovely to be here.
I'm glad you are. I fell in love with your work years ago when I read Three Dog Life and Safekeeping, and then I fell in love again when I read your book, Writing Memoir, for AARP, and I teach from it often, and then I knew it was a long-term marriage for me when I read What Comes Next and How to Like It. And I am not alone, of course, in my feelings, so I wanted to read to our listeners what Elizabeth Gilbert says on your book blurb page. I would follow Abigail Thomas on any journey she ever takes. The arrival of a new book from this master is always a cause for celebration because I know right away that I'm about to learn something important about the art of writing and the art of living, both. I come to her books as though to a feast and leave fulfilled and transformed. And that is my feeling exactly. So I want to thank you for writing and thank you for being here with us.
Well, thank you. That's a really extremely nice quote, and thank you very much for reading it and feeling
yeah,
the same
well,
way.
You
I
know,
feel a little like I know. A fraud over here, but that's...
You're not. And when she says it's a feast and leaves you fulfilled and transformed, what I think about is very fine dining where you don't have to eat this like enormous amount and come away so in pain in your stomach because
oh God, I'm full.
Yeah, because your writing fills us and transforms us, but it's brief. And I know that in some of your books about writing memoir, you've said that your mind works in short form. Perhaps we could begin there, talking about short form and how it influenced your new book, What Comes Next and How to Like It.
Well, the fact is that I have a very bad memory, except for what I remember. And what I remember are moments. I haven't lived my life like a novel. I've lived my life, as many of us do, in bursts of hilarity or grief or understanding or chaos and just what the hell is going on. And those are the things I write about. When I wrote Safekeeping, it was after somebody I'd known a long time died, and these little pieces came flying out of me. I had no idea what they were. I had no idea what I was doing until I was done. But you don't mess with the muse when she's sending you stuff. So I wrote what I remembered, and what I didn't remember was probably boring. When I write longer than a page or two, I get very tired of myself. And I also figure that if you're trying to give to somebody else the memory and the feeling of something that was important to me, you just try very hard to hit the mark, and then you stop. You don't need to keep going. You don't need to talk about the weather. You just, if you've hit the mark, you stop, and then move on to the next thing. I can't bear myself if I write at any length about myself. I'm so bored.
Well, that's really how poetry works. And a problem for writers, though, is knowing when they hit the mark. How do you know that?
Well, you have that, it's really very silly to say this, but you have that round feeling. You have the feeling that maybe you get when you're fully pregnant. You just know you're done. And if you don't know if you're done, you show it to somebody whose opinion you really value. And if someone says, nah, this isn't working, then you go back. But if this person says, yep, you got it, then you keep going.
I'm so glad you mentioned showing it to people. I work with a lot of people and come across people who apologize for sending something too early or don't want to send something until they've struggled and struggled. And I think getting that trusted reader's opinion is the hugest jumpstart you can get to fixing it if it needs fixing, or accepting that it's done if it is. And
always save your first draft, because even if your first draft doesn't work, it's where the fire was. Even if what is in the first draft never appears when you're finished, go back to it, because you'll catch fire again. And the words will be different, but you will know where you were headed much better than if you write on a computer and then it's all gone away.
And don't you think, too, that what feeds the fire is the music in those words? That even if they're not exactly the right words, they have something essential?
And the rhythm. For me, the rhythm is the most important thing. Mm. If the rhythm isn't working, then nothing is working. And I don't know how to say that any better than, you know, when you read something out loud, you've written, and your voice goes dead, okay, that's either a paragraph that needs to be disappeared, or there's something behind that paragraph, like something hiding behind the couch, and you have to look over and see, what did this take the place of that I don't really want to write about, and then move on from there. It's hard. It's hard writing memoir. It's hard to cop to the things you really wish you didn't know about yourself and are discovering as you write, but that's where the heart is.
I agree, and I wonder if this is a good time for us to hear a little bit from your memoir.
Actually, I was going to read something that was published in a book called Thinking About Memoir, and it's in the back of the paperback. The paperback of What Comes Next includes a bunch of other little pieces of writing. This is called The Making of a Memory. The 1st of January, 2007, my husband Rich died. I was invited to Belize by my old friend Anne, and Chuck was asked to come too. Chuck is my oldest friend. I hesitated. Rich had so recently died, I didn't want to go. Then I remembered what an old friend had told me. She was in her 80s and recounted the story of her own husband's death. Not long after he died, she had been invited to go to Europe with friends. She, too, hesitated until someone whispered in her ear, "Always take a cookie when the plate is being passed." She went, and so did I. Blue everything, blue, 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 and green. The tree next to the porch had leaves as big and round as lily pads, and at night the moon shone silver all over them like spilled mercury. Everything was beautiful, and we were far away. We had no telephone. Pelicans are my favorite birds, and there were lots of them smashing into the water for fish and later hanging their heavy wings out to dry like gray laundry. I love that pelicans have no table manners, no grace. It's all about the food. But I also saw frigate birds, my husband's favorite, and it seemed that whenever I thought of Rich, a frigate bird appeared in the sky overhead. I cried. We ate fried jack for breakfast with honey and jam. We ate bacon and eggs and papaya and pineapple. We ate lobster and shrimp. We bounced around in a rusty truck on red dirt roads, and when it failed to start, we learned from two young men we met in the parking lot of a bank how to jump it. One morning, in the lone tall pines at one end of the beach, there appeared a single buzzard. Later that afternoon, he was standing on a little spit of land at Rum Point. He was leaning toward the ocean, and he never moved. I decided he was scanning the horizon, waiting for his mate to come back. His own true love were the words I used to myself. "You've got to hand it to him," I said to Anne. "He hasn't budged in an hour. He hasn't even moved his head. That is one patient bird." "I don't think that's a bird," she said. "It doesn't have a head." So I set off down the beach. My buzzard turned out to be a long, bleached stick around which a black garbage bag had gotten tangled. I don't know why I wasn't disappointed. Maybe being blown together by random bits of trash made it more buzzard-like. Memory seems to be an independent creature, inspired by event, not faithful to it. Maybe memory is what the mind does with its free time. The thing is, I'm old enough now to know that the past is every bit as unpredictable as the future, and that memory, mine anyway, is not a record of anything, and truth is not an absolute. I have a feeling that if I remember anything about Belize in future years, only the buzzard will make the cut. And I will remember him on his little spit of land, looking out to sea, waiting for his own true love to return.
Abigail, thank you so much.
Oh.
You have me in tears.
Oh.
And what a gift of life you've written during a time of grief.
Well, you know about that too, right?
I do.
That's all we can do. Well, it's not all we can do, but we can do it. We can make something out of what has absolutely no meaning. We have to find our own meaning, don't we?
I think so.
I don't think anything happens for a reason. I don't think God has a plan. I think when something terrible happens, you have to find the meaning for yourself.
I think so. I also think that we're very lucky as writers to have that tool to bring life back by looking and observing and naming, all of which we just experienced in your writing. So I hope my voice isn't too quavery as we continue, because you've just got me straight in the heart.
That's so nice of you. Thank you. Thank you.
I am wondering how you were lucky enough with your publisher republishing your book as a paperback to be able to add bonuses like this to your already.
It was their idea.
Really?
Why don't we put a little something extra in the back? And there were things that my son had helped me drive somewhere, and we had an hilarious conversation, and that went in, and a little lagniappe, as they say in New Orleans, something extra. It was a sweet idea.
I'll be looking forward to getting the paperback. I, of course, have had the hardcover for quite a while and am blown away by it. And
I think
that because I read your blog, which we'll talk about a little later, I know something of what people have said about the book. And I know that some of it was difficult. Most people are responding the way I am and Elizabeth Gilbert. But do you want to address what happens to a writer when there's something critical said that seems off base, but nonetheless is out there?
Well, I've only gotten really one really horrendously bad review. And that, of course, was in the New York Times.
Right,
which... a woman named Catherine Powers, in which she called me a serial memoirist. And I thought, do we call them serial poets? Do we call them serial novelists? Which seemed to be first to completely ignore the fact that people who write memoir are often writing from loss.
Mm-hmm.
They're not writing just because they want to talk about what they've done with their lives. They're writing from loss, as I was, and trying to figure out where this fits in. How do I make something out of this? How can I honor what's gone? It was such a bad review. She even said, we don't know where the money came from to buy the house in Woodstock. And I thought, what are you talking about? This is not a book about money. This is a book about catastrophe. She referred to my husband, Rich, who had had a traumatic brain injury, as the unfortunate Rich, which was kind of the understatement of the year. But it was such a bad review, and I first read it. My editors didn't want me to see it, and my agent didn't want me to see it. But I laughed. I laughed my head off. And I posted it on Facebook saying, this is the worst review I've ever seen. And it was actually kind of fun, because people who'd read it were appreciative, and then there were some people who hadn't read it, dug at me with little jabs. I don't basically care what, once you've written it and you've gone through the agony you have to go through to face things that you have a hard time facing, not only about life, but about yourself. Once you've done that, it really doesn't matter what anybody else thinks, because you've had to look at it yourself. That's what I did. I pasted this really horrendous review on Facebook, and it was a lot of fun.
I think I saw it, and it was a lot of fun, especially you also reading the responses. So I think what you said is really important, that we do, first of all, write for ourselves. But in my world of writing, if it doesn't reach the hearts and minds of other readers, even if it's only one, it hasn't come fully manifest. It's still somehow hidden inside you. So I think publishing and having an audience, especially an audience who doesn't know you, is really important. But it's also really important to filter out the kind of misplaced audience. And when I listened to you, I thought, I would love to be called a serial memoirist, because serial anything means you've got more in you. You have. You're right.
Yes.
I mean, who says that a writer should stop after one poem or one story or one novel? And
I know. It was... it was such a funny thing to use as a slight, a slur.
It was.
I mean, God, poets write hundreds, well, not hundreds, but many books. Novelists write many books. There was something sort of nasty about serial memoirists. This woman can't stop writing about herself.
Yeah.
But in fact, it wasn't really that at all.
Right.
Three awful things happened, and I tried to make sense of them. That's
right.
It. That's
right.
All there is. I hope I never write another memoir. I hope I never have reason to.
Whoa.
I hope nothing devastating ever happens again.
I hope so,
but
too.
That's how.
But I like the how to like it, so maybe there's many wonderful things that aren't devastating that you might write about.
There are.
Good.
And you know what? You kind of have to like it.
Yeah.
You have to find a way to like it, even if the path isn't clear.
Right.
You know what? Life can be just so full of suffering, but it's also hilarious, and it's interesting. Life is interesting. What you notice is interesting. And that's really all you need, right? I mean, if you can laugh, if you still notice things, if you hear somebody say something and you need to write it down because it's just so cool, that's being alive.
Absolutely.
You need to be alive.
You are listening to KPTZ 91.9 Port Townsend. In case you've just joined us, you're listening to In Conversation with Sheila Bender, discussions on writing and the writing life. Today, Sheila is talking with Abigail Thomas, novelist, memoirist, and painter, and author of What Comes Next and How to Like It.
Do you think that your book, What Comes Next, somehow struck very deeply at something that this critic did not want to look at in her own life?
Well, I tried to think about that. I tried to think, what about this made you so very angry? Because she was really angry. And I couldn't figure it out. I just thought, what bug was up your undergarment? I don't know. It was the only really devastatingly terrible review, except it wasn't devastating because I laughed so hard. I'm, what?
Right.
What? Is this what you want to know? This isn't what the book is about. Anyway.
But that's the important thing, is that a book find its right audience, and hopefully there would be people who would read that review and go, I better read this book.
Well, I think there were a few, but not as many as would have been if somebody had loved it. But that's how it goes. You write it, it goes out there, and it's on its own.
Right.
I have nothing you can do.
Recommended this book to so many of my clients and students and peers. There isn't one of them who hasn't said, oh my God, this is the most wonderful thing I've read this year.
Oh, sure. So, that's such a nice thing to say.
Thank you. So books have to find their proper audience, and they do, despite the critics. A co-writer and myself wrote a book years ago called Writing in a Convertible with the Top Down. It was our attempt at through
that's
letters.
That's a great title.
It was our attempt through letters to each other to talk about our writing lives and how they are anchored in our personal lives and what happens to us every day. It was reviewed in Publishers Weekly, and it was called by the, I think, male reviewer, epistolary twaddle.
Oh, my God.
And it's sort of like we should make a list of reviewer terms, serial memoirs.
The thing is that really, that's not a review. That's a judgment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's not a review. I think the PW guys and girls, or men and women, are so underpaid, and they're probably all graduate students, and they're not, or they would be, and they don't really always understand.
Yeah,
that's extremely irritating, Sheila.
It is. Well, our book really was based in metaphor. It was a book about how you can skillfully use metaphor in your writing, in your composing of a whole story. How do you make one thing like another thing for a richness of writing? And the reviewer went on to say that it was sort of like all we talked about was metaphor. So I figured that the person probably was a graduate student steeped in intellectual critical theory, and this would not reach that kind of person because their mind had been changed. So as writers, I think we do find our tribe, and we do flourish in that
we
tribe.
We find our tribe, or our tribe finds us, and grateful, grateful, grateful for that.
And so speaking
really
about
grateful, that,
you're writing a blog, which people can access on your website, which is abigailthomas.net. And I wondered if you could tell us anything about what drove you to write a blog.
Well, I wrote it for a while because I was writing all these little pieces that had no home. And so I put them up on a blog. But since then, the little pieces I'm writing that have no home, I'm just sticking in a file saying new work, because the blog thing wasn't really working for me. And the word blog sounds as though you've stuck your finger down your throat and are retching it up. So it gave me a place to put stuff that I had nowhere else to put. But I've taken some of those and tried to do a little more with them and put them someplace else. I haven't got the willpower or I don't seem to be able to keep it up. I'm so lazy. And so I do write what I write, but it's going someplace else right now. I suppose I should stick it up there. I mean, it's a lot of little pieces that just exist because they exist, because this is what happened on February 8th. It's fun, but I feel like a failed blogger.
I think you're not alone. I think that's one of the hardest things about a blog, is maintaining that momentum. But it served you, and it certainly served the people who read it. So now your file sounds like it's serving you. Your sounds like a paper file.
It's helpful. It's helpful to see, as I'm sure it is for everybody, what has caught your eye, what it is that's kind of fascinating you about daily life. And once you know that, then you've got something going on.
Right.
Then you wake up in the morning with that feeling that you're in gear. Oh, my God, I can't wait.
That's
a
good feeling.
I can't wait to see what comes out. Yeah.
So what about your presence on Facebook? You mentioned that you posted the review on Facebook. Do you post things for writers on Facebook?
I don't. The reason I got into Facebook in the first place was to keep track of my children. If somebody wasn't speaking to me, I could find out what they were doing by being on Facebook. Or if somebody had photographs, and since photographs are all digital now and I wasn't getting any, I could find grandchildren on Facebook. I'm not sure how to use Facebook exactly, except that it was fun to put the bad review up. And every now and then, there's something just, people put their breakfasts on Facebook.
No.
I don't eat breakfast.
You could put an empty
plate. So I got nothing in the morning for Facebook. There's something many years ago when I was working at Viking Press and Muhammad Ali lost a fight. It was in the early 80s. And I don't remember who he was fighting, but they had said he just doesn't look good anymore. And I was walking along 59th Street to go to work, and there was a huge limo idling there. And I looked at it, and in the window was Muhammad Ali. And I walked over, and he put the window down all the way, and I said, "You still look pretty goddamn good to me."
Oh.
And that was one of my favorite moments of my life.
I bet, especially within.
But I got no way to put that on Facebook. Oh, it's just, so I'm glad we're having this conversation.
Oh, well, I'm glad listeners will hear, especially now when we're reading so much about him because of his death.
Yeah. My God, what a man.
Yeah, but that is the kind of thing people would put on Facebook.
There's no way I could do that, but it was a big moment in my life.
Yes, well, now it's a big moment in ours, and so thank you for that story. And it goes along with what you said about memory and what sticks and what doesn't stick and how...
Sometimes
that was a very big event, but sometimes something as small as an empty breakfast plate can be
exactly
what we remember. I know you've taught a lot of students, and I know you taught at the New School in New York City. What was your experience teaching people to get to the place where you start from as a writer?
Well, I still teach, and I taught at the New School, but I also taught privately at home. I found that when people are just beginning, it's like a child with a really big box of crayons and all that white paper, and they don't know what the hell to draw or where to begin. So I give little assignments, which I did at the New School and I've done in all my workshops. Almost always, these assignments will snag something in somebody's memory that gives them a side door, because I think often what you need to write about is so intimidating, you can't approach it by the front door. But if you have a side door to go through, then you can actually do it. And thinking about memoir, I remember I was teaching at Tin House one summer many years ago, and I gave the assignment to write two pages in which someone is inappropriately dressed for the occasion, figuring that everybody's at a moment when they have the wrong clothes on. And a woman wrote about her first husband's death. He had been helping somebody move with a pickup, and he didn't even know the person, but he was that kind of guy. And he was helping him load the truck and helping him do what he needed to do. And at some point, the truck moved, and he was declared brain dead. The accident that happened from that, her husband was declared brain dead when they got to the hospital. She was up on the roof with his brother, walking around, trying to decide whether to take him off life support, and thinking, these are the wrong clothes to be wearing while I'm making a decision like this. Cutoffs, flip-flops, a T-shirt. And that was her way into writing about the whole thing. She had felt inappropriately dressed for the occasion of deciding to take her husband off life support. It was it was extremely moving.
And I'm sure.
It gave her the side door. Because you can't write about walking on the roof just plain like that. You've got to have the side door. You've got to have the way in.
Mm-hmm.
Like when I wrote about in What Comes Next and How to Like It, my daughter got cancer sort of halfway through this book, and I had absolutely no way to write about that. In fact, I couldn't write at all. It was so it was so terrifying. And then one day, one of my dogs took out the dog door, her favorite baseball cap with a wig attached, and that gave me a way to write about Catherine having cancer.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, I couldn't have done it. You need a way in that isn't the front door. That's what assignments give you. I think that's also what noticing everything around you gives you.
Absolutely. I was going to say it also goes with what you said about memory, that some things are just so deep in your memories. And I think it's true also in the now, like when you saw the cap with the wig. Sometimes these objects that don't seem to have meaning suddenly trigger so much.
Oh, absolutely. And that's what one of the great things about being a writer, Sheila, don't you think? You really do. Your nerves are always, for better or for worse, alert and alive. We notice things, and then every now and then what we're noticing gives us a way in, gives us something, a way to write about something we otherwise have no way of writing about. We're alive, alive, alive for all that goes bad and good.
Thank you.
With it.
And I want to recommend very highly Thinking About Memoir and Two Pages, both of them by you, Abigail Thomas. And people can see more about your books and your writing life at abigailthomas.net. And I hope they'll go there to read. And then to read more of your books, because they really are, just like our conversation today, such a boon for writers who do face that blank page. Like you said, children, what shall I draw? If someone says, write about a time you were inappropriately dressed, okay, I can write about that. So I'm sad to say that our time together is ending, and I want to thank you so, so much for doing this interview with us.
I'm honored to have been asked. I'm really honored to have been asked. Thank you very, very much.
In Conversation is produced by Sheila Bender and edited by Charlie Fleischman.